Please welcome to the stage from SoulCycle, Julie Rice and Elizabeth Cutler, and from Pando, Sarah Lacy.
For 90 minutes, so 6% of your day. It's how we show each other love. We're gonna stay in the room the whole time. If you need to sit down and just roll out your legs, that's fine. I have basically an hour of SoulCycle bits that I could do, all Ianisms.
I'm ready for that.
I have, over the course of PandoMonthlys, interviewed Facebook founders, Twitter founders, major venture capitalists, people who built industries. This is the most starstruck I've been because I use your product constantly. So I will probably be 10% more gibbering idiot. I'll get used to it and start asking my usual rude, obnoxious questions, but probably not for a little bit and probably not till a glass of wine. Thank you for being with me.
Oh, thank you for
You're
having us.
You're also only the, we've literally done like probably hundreds of hours of PandoMonthly interviews, you were the second and third women we've had ever. Isn't that horrible?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. You're building a great company to correct that. Let's talk about your journey. I know I've read a little bit about the story about how you guys met, but even going back before that, where were you before? How did you start your careers, and what was your relationship to fitness like?
Oh, Julie's story is so much more interesting. You should start with her.
Right. Everyone wants to hear about Hollywood.
It's so glamorous.
Right. Well, I lived in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. I worked in the movie business. I worked with actors. And I had lived on the East Coast my whole life, moved there for my career. And, you know, fitness on the West Coast, really, at least at the time, was really different than anything I had experienced in New York. I mean, mm-hmm. people really exercised as part of their social life. It was something you did with friends instead of getting drinks. It was really a valued part of a lifestyle. And when I moved back to New York, there was just nothing that existed like that. I sort of tried all different gyms and all different fitness propositions, and there were a lot of ways to burn calories, but not a lot of ways to really have an experience, have something social, find a little bit of a community. Mm-hmm. And so I was really a user looking for that kind of an experience.
Mm-hmm. And what about you?
What was the question?
What did you do before this? What was your background?
Oh, what did I do before this? Oh, okay. So I lived in Telluride for a long time. I mm-hmm. sort of accidentally happened to like end up there. I thought I was going to live in a big city. And we used to hike and like talk and get our exercise while we were like hanging out with our friends. And then when I moved to New York, I ended up having kids. I got really, really, I gained a lot of weight when I was pregnant, like mm-hmm. a lot. And my very best girlfriend, she just sat me down and she was like, honey, you're never going to lose that 65 pounds if you don't get cardio. And so she took me to a class, and I had such a revelation in that class. I just felt like I just wasn't a person who could do anything other than a yoga class. I couldn't access fitness at all. And having lost the mountains, it was like I had lost my access to fitness. And it just changed my life to get on that bike and to just feel like I could do something that was not only for myself, but that was also really good for me. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, it was great because I got my body back. And, you know, after you go through that, it feels good to have that happen.
Right, right. No, I think, I mean, largely credit to SoulCycle. I'm in far better shape now than I was pre-two kids. I mean, it is.
And you like it.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, and it's.
And you look forward to going.
That's sort of
the punchline.
And I want to get into the business model a little bit mm-hmm. later, because I think it's fascinating. But it's like, mm-hmm. there is something about, everyone bitches about how expensive it is, but it's like, you will go because you paid that money and that money will be gone. It's the thing that gets you out of bed at like 7 a.m.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, when we started the business, you know, Elizabeth and I sort of went back and forth, you know, how much should we charge? I mean, we knew what we wanted to deliver in terms of an experience, and we knew what it cost to deliver something like that. And I will never forget, Elizabeth looked at me and she said, you know, people really value what they pay for. Mm-hmm. And there is just something about the entire experience where, first of all, it's a pay-per-class model. So, mm-hmm. you know, you don't have to come, and we're not going to charge your credit card every
month.
Which
is amazing because, like, the whole gym and fitness industry in America, like, the reason it's a big business, even though, as a country, we're really fat and out of shape, mm-hmm. is because they sort of appeal to this version of you that you want to make sense. I mean, Atkins makes money whether you follow the diet or not. You buy the book. And, you know, gyms charge you monthly whether you come or not. I mean, it's a bold thing to say we're only going to make money if people continue to work out.
I mean, big box gyms actually, they actually count on a lot of people not coming so that they can oversell memberships and make sure that, you know, they have enough space and equipment. Absolutely. I mean, when we started the business, I mean, there was no boutique fitness in New York City. There were a few yoga classes. I think Exhale had just opened, and that was about it. And so when we told people what we were doing, you know, everybody looked at us and said, why would you do that? People can already get that for free in their gym. Mm-hmm. You know, so for us in the beginning, it was not even about saying, oh, we're going to create the best indoor cycling class. It was really about creating a marketplace to put our own product into.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that took a lot longer than actually, you know, sort of figuring out how to get the product right, but sort of conditioning people that they should pay for something that sort of was already on the buffet.
Right. Well, we'll get more into the business model in a second, but getting back to you guys' story and how you met. So you're both sort of in New York. You're both from New York transplants, and we're longing for something else. And I understand a friend sort of set you guys up on a blind co-founder date. Mm-hmm.
It was crazy. It was like we really joked that it was the best blind date. I never went on one, but it was the best blind date either one of us has ever been on.
I've been on quite a few.
Because it's like, really, I mean, like, when you have that kind of connection with somebody and you almost can hear what they're going to say before they say it, and what they're saying, you know, is so true, and you're really connecting to that message. I mean, it was fantastic, and we just kind of immediately started finishing each other's sentences, and what about this, what about that, what about this, what about that, and the conversations continued on for these 8 years, and it's been an incredible experience for me, and I know for Julie too.
And how quickly after meeting did you know you guys were going to do this?
I mean, it was immediate. That was the whole thing. It's like
that day.
Yeah, it's like, yes. I remember when I met my husband, my best friend's aunt was like, well, you know, it's okay if you haven't known him that long, because when you find a good handbag, you don't have to go shopping for another handbag. You know, you have a good handbag. And so it was kind of like we found a good handbag in each other.
No, we left lunch, and I remember before the door of my cab had even closed, my cell phone rang, and it was Elizabeth, and this is what she said to me. She said, okay, here's the thing. I'm going to look for real estate, and you research towels. We'll meet on Thursday.
Julie had a desk job, and I was found.
I was still working in the movie business, and I thought, okay, well, I better. So I went back to my desk, and I Googled towels. And
I feel like you had the easier job. I feel like towels are a lot easier.
Yeah, well, it's actually not. It turns out you rent them in the beginning. You actually don't get to own them because you don't have laundry. I figured that out. And sure enough, she called me on Wednesday night and she said, I found something on Craigslist. Mm-hmm. Let's meet on the Upper West Side tomorrow. And we literally 3.5 days later, we found our first space. And we always say sort of,
it was meant to be.
Yeah, we always say everything about SoulCycle sort of was just, you know, the world really wanted it to be born, because it was one of those things where, you know, it was an old dance studio, so it was actually zoned for our usage. Mm-hmm. It was a 5-year sublet, so we didn't sort of choke on the fact that if we couldn't make a go of it, we figured we'd have this sublet for 5 years, and we kind of figured out all the different things we could do with the space if it didn't work out. And it's interesting because when we went to open our second studio, it was actually so difficult to find a space that we always sort of say, if it had been that way the first time around, at a certain point we probably would have just said, you know, this isn't meant to happen. It's too hard to open a business in New York City. But sure enough, there was this dance studio, and we built the front desk out of IKEA cabinetry. Elizabeth had a little Audi station wagon at the time. It took us like 6 trips to Secaucus to get all the cabinetry in the back of the car.
That's awesome.
And I mean, our first studio was in the rear lobby of a building on West 72nd Street. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until sort of after we had signed the lease that we realized we weren't actually going to get a sign on the front of the building. Which, you know, if you one tip I can leave people with is, if you are going to open a business in New York City, using the density
business
is a great thing.
Very good.
It was fine. It was fine. And, you know, we separated the studio from our reception with a little glass wall. And we built our front desk out of the IKEA cabinetry. And the whole thing was, you know.
So how similar to a SoulCycle today did that first studio look? Because you guys are really religious about wanting that experience to be the same experience. And even when you've done pop-ups at things like CES and I assume South by Southwest, you know, you got the lockers, you've got the front desk. Mm-hmm. Like, you want it to be that experience. Did that evolve over time?
It did. You know what's amazing about our first studio? I mean, honestly, if you walked into today, you would be like, this is such a dump. our lease had expired, and I remember it was such an emotional day, our last day in that studio. We're all, I mean, it really, truly, it was so moving. And I remember feeling like,
we had a breakfast studio party, yeah, and everybody came. We gave everybody spray paint, amazing, and everybody spray painted the word. And if you're a soul cycler, obviously you know that you have like a word, whether it's, you know, strength. Or, yeah. Everybody sprayed their word on the wall. Yeah. We took pieces of the walls with us.
Yeah. Like the Berlin Wall.
Oh, it was, I mean,
or they
people,
could just say whatever they wanted
we were
to
shutting
on the wall,
down
so
the studio.
Great.
Because after the 5 years, and I don't mean to interrupt you, but after the five years, they basically said to us, they wouldn't let us renew the lease, mm-hmm, because we thought we were going to see 75 people a day. By the time we left there, we were seeing 300-400 a day.
They didn't like, it was
people were
many
changing
people
on the streets. I mean, this space was not
they
equipped
were,
for the
not,
business.
Yeah.
So when we went to renew the lease, they said
the
no way.
In the building was a little bit right, misused.
And I mean, we assured people, all of our like really loyal customers, we were going to build them something better. But the same place that would look was such a dump in the beginning that we could barely convince people to come to. I mean, people thought it was tragic to leave. I mean, we were weeping on the bikes that night.
We really were. It was really, it was very sad. But then I looked up at the ceiling and it was super gross. And so I was pretty sad. I was psyched to leave. But the great thing about that studio is that it informed so much of what SoulCycle became. Yes. And that's something that we'll always be so grateful for. So like, as you walked into the studio, there was a long hallway that doubled as the locker room. Mm-hmm. So you would naturally bump into people, like if you like rode on Tuesdays and Thursdays and Friday, like eventually you'd end up seeing these people and you'd kind of like say hi, or I like that song, or and then people started like having further conversations, and then people started having friendships outside the studios, and then they would have like their SoulCycle friends were like a different subset of friends than their friends in the rest of their lives. Mm-hmm. And these people have become like people that people go on vacation with, like they have really deep, like true relationships. And so we're very proud. I mean, it's an unintended consequence, just the idea that people can form those kinds of connections, and mm-hmm, as a result of like what goes on in that room is kind of awesome. So that happened in the hallway. And then by the time you got to the hallway and we actually saw you at the front desk, like we were so almost freaked out and yet super excited that you were there, mm-hmm, that we like really just loved people so much that we would never want them to leave. So
we really had to fight for every customer,
yeah,
because
for sure,
because we had no sign, mm-hmm, because there was no boutique fitness in New York, because we were charging $27 a class, and
and also spinning is kind of a thing that you think was a trend 10 years ago. Like
yeah,
I was
everybody
telling you guys
said
backstage,
it was dead.
Like I remember the first time I heard about SoulCycle was from Paul Berry, who's you know the CMS gods behind Huffington Post and now Rebel Mouse, and he was like, I was going to their office and he was like, you know, all in this like spandex and he was walking. And I was like, where are you going? He's like, I'm going to SoulCycle. I was like, what are you talking about? And I was like, you're spinning? Like, didn't women do that in the suburbs 10 years ago? And like, I mean, so it's not a natural thing that sounds like, yeah, when you first hear it.
Now, everybody, I mean, literally good friends of mine who are super smart were like, what are you doing? That is dead. Dead, dead, dead. That's from the 80s. Exactly.
So how did you get your first customers? Was it friends of yours? Did you do clever marketing things?
You know, it was always...
Drive us a bike and go out to the street or anything?
Well, it's funny. So we had no sign on the door, and we really went door to door, practically flyering, you know. Somebody would key into a building and we'd kick our foot in and kind of hold the door open and then, you know, flyer bomb the mailroom. And, you know, we were PR and marketing in the beginning. I mean, we were everything. So, you know, we made great packages and, oh God, we spent like 2 weeks trying to deliver these, you know, swag bags to all the different health and beauty editors in New York.
It was post 9/11, so you couldn't get into any of the buildings.
Oh, and it was crazy. You get an address for a magazine, and then it turns out they would never let you deliver a package actually to the front lobby. You have to drive around to the service entrance. I mean, we'd spent more time midtown trying to figure out, you know, how to get these bags delivered. And
I think we thought we were going to go in and actually get to meet people. And the messenger like, hey, service desk was like, you could drop it there.
Yeah, you know, and the truth was, you know, we really went at it guerrilla style, and we really felt like if we could deliver an experience to three people in a day that made them feel excited and was authentic, and we could turn them into evangelists, mm-hmm, then they would go and tell two more people, mm-hmm, and they would go and tell somebody else. And to be totally honest with you, it's really still our marketing strategy.
Right.
I mean, we really rely on our customer service and what we're giving you in the room, so that you don't just come out and think like, oh, that was a good workout. You come out and think, if I'm going to dinner tonight with somebody, I am telling them
right,
what I'm going to spend most of my dinner talking about is what I did at SoulCycle today. I mean, when you talk about the paper class model, I mean, we really strive to deliver that every single time. And, you know, we integrated ourselves into the community. You know, we figured out a way to sort of, be philanthropic and donate a lot of SoulCycle and, you know, make sure that, you know, sort of who we consider our influencers are just really people that are fire starters, you know, community builders. And we made sure to try to identify those people, and we still do.
Right.
As we move into new markets, you know, we sort of all call our five best friends that have some connection to Nashville. And we'll say, like, hey, you know, who are your five friends that you'd like me to send 10 SoulCycle classes to? You know, get them sort of starting to talk about the brand and get the party started. And we really find that, you know, our best marketing efforts are done when, you know, somebody like you would call your friend in another city and say, you're not going to believe what's coming. Because, you know, I think that's really what most brands are looking for these days, you know, is sort of authenticity.
Right.
And that's what we really count on, you know.
What about celebrities? Because you guys have a lot of celebrity writers and a lot of celebrity endorsers. And you know, obviously you came from show business. Was that something that you guys did intentionally, or did it happen? Was that early in your days, or did it come later?
Came pretty early, but I think what we set out to do was really intentionally create a sanctuary for everybody, so that people could feel safe going there, no matter if they were a notable. I mean, it's New York City, so and they're paying for something. So whether somebody's notable, whether they're a celebrity, whether they're just a regular person, we wanted everybody to have the same experience. We really cared about every single person having that experience and making sure that they not only got their money's worth, but they really felt like they got something out of that room that was different.
Because to me, that's the magic of it, is it's like, I mean, I get what you're saying about sort of community in the locker rooms, but the fact that, like, when I'm in that room, no one can talk to me is really important. And I tell you, there was one class that I did on a Sunday, and usually the Sunday 7:30 is not sold out in San Francisco, but it was like totally packed, and I was like, what is going on? And it was like some company had sort of like bought out half the bikes or whatever, and like brought a bunch of these like alpha like sales dudes in there. And they were all like talking and talking and talking, and Bea was the instructor, and she was just like, guys, no talking, no talking. And she basically got off the bike and went over and started turning all their resistance up and just started driving everyone like crazy, so they literally couldn't talk anymore. It was like the most amazing class. But it's like, no matter what is going on, and like, you know, some of you guys like probably know like the drama that I had with Uber last year. The day that all hit, I was actually signed up for an Ian double, and one of them was the Taylor Swift ride. And I had to do so much TV that day, I missed the first one, but I was like, I'm not missing the Taylor Swift ride! So it's like, I go there, I have like armed guards with me, it was like completely ridiculous, and I'd just been like holding it together for like, you know, 2 days. If you don't know, like, there was an Uber executive who had a $1 million plot to destroy my family, like broke. Ooh. It was this whole crazy thing. So so I'm in there, and I've just been like, I've been on every TV network. I've been like holding it together. I've been like being really stoked for my kids and everything else. And I get in there, and it was like a mashup of some Taylor Swift breakup song, and like Titanium came on, and I lost it and started sobbing. And it was like the only moment of that whole drama where it's like my guard was completely down, the facade was completely down, and it was just superhuman. And I think if it hadn't been a dark candlelit room where everyone was focused on their own thing and like no one could talk to me, like that never would have happened.
Well, it's kind of the perfect storm, right? It's the endorphins, it's the music, it's the words that the instructors use. And there is something I think really unique about having the support of a community but not having to interact with people. It's just sort of the most amazing way to sort of feel supported by people and yet to still be able to totally be private.
Yeah. And how much of that was intentional?
It's all intentional.
But you guys knew when you were setting up that first studio, like, it needs to be this, it needs to be this, it needs to be this.
You got to get lost. I mean, that's, I think, what one of the things that we bonded over so much at that first lunch was, like, you get to get lost while you're doing fitness, which most people hate, and to actually find joy in that, getting swept away by the music or getting lost on that lyric or just finding something else where your mind wanders, and then you solve a problem and you're just like, oh my God, and I woke up and I just worked out and I just burned, you know, 500 calories and I just did this in 45 minutes and I can go on with the rest of my day. It was just very efficient. And we're all so time starved. And the other thing that we really thought about from the beginning, which I think is pertinent for this group, is that we wanted it to be a place where there actually was no clock, where there was no electronics, where except for the sound system, obviously, but that it's totally digitally free. And I mean, for us, I mean, many of us, like, we're all so plugged in all day long that to really like touch your own humanity and just like what's actually personally up for you in that room, just like after you're keeping it together,
right,
dealing with people and death threats and security and children and just protecting that. I mean, everybody has these human experiences, and I think that that is something that we sort of hoped would happen, because it certainly happened for us, but I think we'd never expected that that would happen for so many people in the way that it has. And to be
and
totally
in different markets, that's what's so interesting.
Yes, I mean, that has been one of the, honestly, like the biggest gift. Like people ask us, like, how do you know, and how did you, like we're like regular people that just wanted something out there for ourselves that was just gonna kick our ass, honestly, and keep us in good shape. But to find something different on that bike, and then to go and we have a really good friend who has a bunch of restaurants, and we told him we were gonna open in LA, and he was like, "You are dead. Like, I am scared for you. Like, this is never gonna scale. Nobody is ever gonna find what they find in that room in New York, because you guys are not there." And we were like, oh my God, okay. We have to make sure that we get everybody really trained. And it was fantastic because we had been doing this already, but it made the training process of what people actually go through that much more intentional. So like to your point of like, are the soul cycles similar to the first one? They're similar in the sense that because we were so excited to see you and we had not expected to see you actually get down the hallway, there's a certain level of service and there's a lot of training that goes into just actually greeting somebody and making sure that you have their shoes and you have their water and you know what they like and you know what they need and you get them, like you make them feel like they're cared for. So you walk in the front door and you feel elevated. Like mm-hmm. you feel like you're already sort of out of the mundane world.
Well, and to me that is so hard to scale. I mean, I remember there's a famous Harvard Business School case study about a bank that was growing and growing and growing, even though like they were bucking every trend. Like they didn't have like fee-based services. They just had sort of basic checking services. Their fees were way more expensive than anyone else. And they were growing and growing and growing. And so they broke down why. And it all came down to customer service. And they were like, yeah, but every bank says that. Like, how do you actually do it? And they said, oh, it's incredibly simple. We have one bar for hiring tellers, and they have to smile in a resting state. Like their resting face is smiling and not like bitch face.
Oh, that's hilarious.
What a difference it makes though. Who wants to look at bitch face if you're doing business?
Right, and genuinely, like I was intimidated going into SoulCycle first time because it's in the marina, which like I don't have blonde hair and a ponytail. Like I've not gone there like once in 15 years I lived in San Francisco. So like it's a little scary to walk into your first one. And they were so nice at the front desk. Do you have a way of hiring those? Like, do you have a smiling face, resting smiling face trick?
We have more than a resting smiling face. You know, it's interesting. So we really have taken sort of the, you know, the core principles, and we took sort of our learnings from that first studio, and we really flushed them out into a full-blown hospitality school. Mm-hmm. So our employees, I mean, aside from sort of a, you know, a not resting bitch face hiring policy. I mean, our employees go through an incredibly extensive training school. I mean, they're actually in training all the time. Our training team is on the road all the time. So
even the people at the front desk.
Absolutely.
Oh, the people in the front desk go through hours and hours and courses. I mean, we have about 30 different modules of training that they are always, whether it's history of the brand or how to communicate with a colleague or, you know, what is customer service. You know, these modules within our hospitality school are always being delivered over and over. So everybody from, you know, our cleaning staff to our vice presidents are in this school all the time. I mean, when you get hired at SoulCycle, everybody works at the front desk. It doesn't matter what you're hired for. I mean, mm-hmm. everybody spends some time working at the front desk so that they can really understand our business. I mean, mm-hmm. we are a corporate office, you know, where we work, you know, that serves our field. And so people to really understand how to deliver the experience that we're looking for, everybody's got to spend time at the desk. But our front desks are trained in a way, I'm not sure that there are training programs like that out there. We have an amazing woman. We call her our employee number one. When Elizabeth and I were still, the two of us were, you know, switching off, taking shifts at the front desk. She was a rider that wandered in one day, and she had worked at Condé Nast, and she needed to leave because she had some health issues, whatever. And she said, you know, I'm a workaholic and I am a SoulCycle fanatic and your brand has helped me really get much healthier. And I'd love to come and work for you. And we said, you know what, that's amazing. We just don't have any jobs right now. Like, this is the workforce, you know? Mm-hmm. And she said, you know what, let me come in and let me just organize your files for you. We can just start out that way. And right. I always say...
Did you give her free rides?
Great. You want to come in? You know, the office was behind the front desk. You know, we had a piece of plywood that separated the office, which is actually smaller than the section that your chair is in, from the studio. And she came in, and we always say, Amy came in that day. We actually still to this day have never hired her. But she is our VP of culture and hospitality and people. And she runs our entire training programs. I mean, she spends most of her time traveling the whole country, sort of training these different desks. So that's one part of the experience. And, you know, little things, you know, things that you would think are second nature you have to carefully replicate them. You would think that people would know, you know, that, you know, yes is always the answer. You know, when you're a yes person, you would think, okay, you know, you watch somebody and you think, how could you tell that person no? There's a million different ways you could try that. Mm-hmm. But that's actually something that you have to train people to think like. Uh-huh. You know, we always say we're...
And also, people are naturally disposed. They have a natural disposition.
It's a stress job, though, because it's totally. For those of you who don't know, it's like a class opens up, and then, like, the doors open up, and, like, you know, 60 sweaty people come pouring out and, like, all want to get shit out of lockers. At the same time, like, 60 non-sweaty people come in, and they all want stuff from the front desk, and they're all trying to sign in, and, like, everyone's freaked out because you've paid $30, you're not getting back, and if you're more than 44 minutes, if you don't get there 4 minutes before class, they're giving away your bike to all these, like, hopefuls, like, waiting to hope you've gotten caught in traffic so that they can get your bike. Like, those moments in between classes are incredibly high stress. There's, like, I mean, at least in our studio, I'm sure you have bigger ones, like 120 people at times who all want something out of them.
Oh, yeah. I mean, and then you have all the hanger-oners that just, they didn't sign up in time and they need to get them off the wait list and then people want to change their bite. I mean, it's a whole
dance that they do. Mm-hmm. And so that sort of is the hospitality.
Oh, this is for me? Oh, great. Oh, perfect. That's awesome.
Both or no, just Elizabeth? Okay, just you. Yeah, yours works. Sorry. Okay.
So that sort of is the hospitality portion of it. But then the actual in-class experience, I mean, that's a pretty well-designed production.
Yeah.
You know, our instructors, you know, we audition now about 120 people for every 25 that we take.
Uh-huh.
It's an 8-week process.
The audition or the training?
The actual training.
Okay.
So they audition. If you get accepted, it's an 8-week training program.
And how many hours is it?
So these guys are in school full time. I mean, uh-huh. They are in school every day from 9 to 5, and then they ride an additional 5 or 6 times a week. School is, the training program is comprised of everything from lectures and drills to community rides where, you know, our training team comes in and grades them. But these guys are learning how to create those moments. I mean, there's nothing accidental about it.
Right.
You know, the way that you scale an experience like this is sort of making sure that you are teaching people how to deliver a very specific experience. So it's everything from, you know, constructing the ride to music appreciation. Obviously, mm-hmm. constructing your playlist is a huge part of it. And sort of how you put it all together so that, you know, you make sure that the moment that you lose it during the Taylor Swift ride, you know, it feels totally accidental to you. Like, you know, I can't tell you how many people come up to Elizabeth and I in the lobby of studios and say, you know, you're not going to believe it, but I cried on the bike today.
So spin crying is a thing. It was written about in Marie Claire.
Everyone cries on the bike.
Yeah, so apparently it's actually a thing where, like, water's running down your face and you don't know if it's crying or so. This guy in the front audience thinks we're describing the cult. He really, really does. Yeah, the Pando team is doing a ride tomorrow. You can get a bike next to Mark Ames if you want to.
It doesn't happen. It doesn't happen to everybody, but it is available to anybody.
I get it. I get the endorphin rush in China, but
well, because you've never been to SoulCycle.
Ian's class, Taylor Swift ride. Those are my only words for you.
Yeah, it'll get you every time.
You know, and to your point also before of sort of, you know, the brand and the branding. I mean, mm-hmm. we have been, that's one thing I will say, you know, we never knew how big it was going to be or not be, but we were, very particular and very thoughtful from day one about the fact that the brand, whatever that meant, it was going to be or not be.
Yeah.
It was always intentional. I mean, the words that are on the wall, mm-hmm. I mean, every one of those words is well thought about. You know, the design of the studio, the look of our logo, they are all there intentionally to make sure that before you even clip into your bike,
right,
you feel like a rock star, or maybe today you're a warrior, or, right. you know, or you decided that a skull was going to make you feel like a badass,
yeah.
or, you know, there's something about that wheel that makes you feel like part of a team. But whatever it is, I mean, the brand for us, we've definitely, even when we had a very small business, we've always thought about the brand in a much bigger way.
Yeah, the skull is so great. I remember one of the instructors was saying that you were interviewed somewhere and someone was like, did you pick a skull and crossbones because you're a cancer survivor? And you're like, no, because you feel like a badass
totally.
When you put on a skull and crossbones.
Totally.
Like,
absolutely.
And I want to talk about merchandise in a bit. So, you know, I do want to get back to sort of those early days and the risk of building this, because you guys didn't raise money. You didn't have like the cushy sort of, you know, you can still take a salary and there's a soft landing if it all, you know, didn't go well. But so tell us about that. It was 2006, right? So it's a couple years before the huge recession, which was way worse for New York than, you know, it even was for San Francisco. And your husband was working at Lehman, so like,
yeah,
that was going to be
was
difficult.
Really fun.
But you know, when you, so you guys,
it was actually okay in 2006.
Yeah, you guys, so it was before that. We're not
yeah,
to that point
yeah,
yet.
Yeah, yeah.
You guys have lunch. You decide you're doing this. You're doing towels. You're doing like, and you got, you had a baby. Did you guys?
We
both
had
babies?
Babies. I had two babies.
And how old were yours?
I had a 3-year-old and a 5-month-old.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I did not expect to have that entrepreneurial urge at that particular time. But I had it, and so did Julie, and it was kind of awesome that we did.
And how old was yours, Julie?
She had a 5-month-old.
Right. Yeah. So what was it? Because I, you know, I was telling you expectation. A lot of our readers know I raised money for Pando when I was on maternity leave. So 4 months, 5 months was about when we opened up. So I had a similar thing.
And yeah, because we were thinking, how do we get out of here?
Please give me a company. This baby won't stop crying.
I love babies.
No, I didn't want to go back to AOL. That was my impetus. But I mean, you know, a lot of people think that having kids is what takes women out of being entrepreneurs. And increasingly, Katya from Birchbox just had twins. Increasingly, you're seeing so many women building companies who are having young kids at the same time. And I've covered entrepreneurs for 15 years. Mm-hmm. I've never seen it as much as I've seen it now. So why do you guys think that's a trend? Do you think it's a change in culture? Do you think it's seeing more women do it?
I honestly, it's like men have babies too.
Right.
You know, so it's like, it's just what you decide as a family. I mean, I think Julie, you should speak. For me, I just felt a strong urge to do it. And I just also felt like if I'm not listening to my own voice, then what am I even listening to? Like, why would I not do this? Although I never expected, to be totally candid, that it would ever be this much work. And if
right.
I had really known that, I probably would have thought about it twice. I'm sure Julie would have been fine, but I'm not sure I would have.
I sort of slowly worked her into it.
Oh, my God. With the two kids and then the Lehman meltdown, I mean, that was really an epic couple of years. But, no, I don't know. I mean, we work with so many women, and they have little kids, and they bring it every day, and it's very creative, and they're you know, you multitask, and you always, what's that saying, like the busiest people get the most stuff done?
Right.
So I guess I'm not surprised by the trend, and mm-hmm. I'm also have to say, like, I'm a little bit proud of the trend. It's funny, I was talking to my daughter the other day, she's 12 now, and, you know, I was saying, like, what is it like for you just having a mom who works so much? Like, are you okay with that? And she was like, are you kidding me? She's like, I go to school and all the boys say, you know, only boys are CEOs. And she's like, uh-uh, my mom's a CEO. And I'm like, wow, okay. You know, I mean, that's kind of like a great message to put out there, that really anybody who has
yeah.
a dream can achieve it. And if they work hard enough and they, you know, stick to it long enough, like, something can happen for them. Anyway, on this particular day, and thank you for that one sip of wine, which was obviously all I needed to get going.
You know, one thing I do think that, you know, you have a baby, and all of a sudden I do think that, you know, what's important to you changes,
mm-hmm.
and it really gives you a moment to sort of examine, you know, did I love what I was doing? Was it something that really fed me? Because, you know, you have this child
yeah.
now, and now it really becomes a choice. You know, I think that you know, for me anyway, you know, to leave my kids,
yeah,
you know, and, you know, be, work the way that we work, it really had to be for something that I was super passionate about.
Yeah.
And the one thing I can say is great, and, you know, about being, you know, an entrepreneur and being a mom, is that, you know, you can work 18 hours a day, but you can still go on the class trip.
Yeah.
And you can still figure out, you know, it might mean you have to work a little later at night.
Right,
or
flexibility.
You know, and one thing that we sort of learned really early on, we're very lucky because we have four girls between us, and they're all sort of close in age. I have a little one, but we bring her along. But it's one thing that's been great is that, you know, in the beginning, I think for us, something that was super stressful was work-life balance. Mm-hmm. And I think what we really found was work-life integration.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's been amazing. You know, our daughters come with us to open up new cities. I mean, it's so, you know, they were behind the front desk, you know, giving water to customers when they were 3 and 4 and 5 years old. And I do think that there is, you know, to Elizabeth's point, you know, for them, I think it's they're really proud. Like, mm-hmm. they were part of this business. I mean, they really, really were. You know, in the beginning, we didn't have a lot of help and a lot of sitters.
Right.
And, you know, I remember, when I was the publicist, you know, if a reporter called and wanted to write something, you know, and I didn't have a sitter, like, that kid was coming with, you know.
Yeah.
You know, so the thing is, these kids have really been a part of it. And I think that it's been pretty amazing for them to sort of grow up. They really understand it. Mm-hmm. Because it's not like, they're in our office all the time. They're in
right.
the studio all the time. I mean, my kids still wake up on Saturday morning and want to know which studio we're working at.
Uh-huh. And they now get to do it with you because they're old enough, right?
They love it, of course. I mean, it's the thrill of their lives. And so I do think that there's really something super powerful about being able to integrate your kids and sort of, you know, they really understand what mommy does. And, you know, I think that for them, I think that the sense of ownership and watching something go like that, I think it's pretty amazing.
Yeah, my parents were both teachers, and I was lucky enough to have both of them as teachers. And being able to see my parents, especially my mom, because I grew up in the South, where there's not always the best attitudes towards female empowerment. And to be able to see my mom in her area of doing what she did better than anyone else that had nothing to do with me, like, totally made me think differently about her.
Yeah, and then that's most cool. of the time they're not that impressed by you anyway. No. You know, and then most dad does the math homework, and my big daughter wishes I still knew famous people.
Right. She's like, Mom, why'd you leave movies? I know, I always feel like Elon Musk's kids, like, I wonder if they're like jaded because they're like, oh, we gotta go to the rocket factory again, or the car factory, woohoo. You know. But that's the other great thing about building a company and having kids is it's like you can have the shittiest day in the world and like you go home and your kids are like thrilled to see you, or you can like think you're a total badass and you go home and you're like, you know, you're changing a diaper. It's like it's very grounding one way or another.
Absolutely.
You mentioned earlier about the lack of digital in the studios. And I think one thing that's really interesting is you guys, in a way, fly in the face of a lot of fitness trends around gamification, around measurement, around quantified self. I mean, inherent in SoulCycle is there's no numbers on the wheel. And unlike other, you know, spinning studios, there's not ranks. You don't know how you're doing in class. And one of our reporters wrote earlier today about sort of why he got really into SoulCycle, because he's very unlikely. and he was saying that part of it is, you know, if he's like wheezing on a bike, no one knows how much he has it turned up. Like, he could really be pushing himself, or he could be brand new to the class, and he kind of has that plausible deniability. But I would think that, you know, some of those trends are effective. That ability to see if you're better today than you were yesterday, or how many calories you're burning, or, you know, if you're pushing it harder than anyone else. You know, I'm curious what went into that thought process. Was there any give and take there, or did you guys just know you didn't want to bring any of that into the room?
Well, it's easy to bring that into the room if you want it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I also think, sort of to Julie's point about just about bringing it, like, I mean, in terms of, like, health and where we need to go with our fitness, I mean, personal accountability is really what is the most important thing in somebody being successful doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And like, you know, if you're cheating on the bike, like, you're cheating,
right.
and the only person you're cheating is you,
right.
which is like crazy. So I think, you know, it's, I mean, from the very beginning, we kind of just felt like this could be like a cell phone free zone. Cause I mean, remember also in 2006, when we started, it was so crazy. You used to have to go to your gym 90 minutes before you would sign up for your class, put your name on a list, and then sign up for your 45-minute class. It was totally inefficient, and we had the first reservation system. How crazy is that? 2006, there were no reservation systems in New York City for fitness. Mm-hmm. And then think about how much, to the point of gamification, let alone being able to sign up for your stuff in advance, things have changed so rapidly. So we were always on the early part of being technology-enabled. But we wanted to keep that kind of conversation for outside the room. It's totally fine if you want to get it inside the room. There are lots of devices with which you can do that. But it's fun, actually, to hear people talk about it when they walk out.
Yeah. No, one of my favorite things is the instructors who say, you know, if you need to take a break, that's fine. I'm never going to come over and yell at you. They start screaming at you in the middle of class. They're like, I didn't say sit down. It's definitely. Like, you hypocrite. You told me you weren't going to yell at me.
With love.
I know. It's a lot of love.
And a sense of humor.
I have abs of love.
Look, in 2006, I mean, people were not really talking about wearables that kind of stuff, you know. And obviously over the years, to Elizabeth's point, we've seen people wear, you know, everything from fuel bands and Fitbits and all that kind of stuff into the room. You know, we are currently in the process of, you know, working on a bunch of different digital stuff. And, you know, at some point we may or may not decide that, you know, we will put something, you know, underneath the seat that you can press that can link to a something later on. You know, something that does not actually allow you to know that the technology's in the room, but you can actually get your data afterward. Mm-hmm. But I will say, you know, it definitely was one of the things that really was one of the core, you know, principles and things that we'd always hoped for when we started this business, was that in that room, you would find your own inner athlete. You know, for me, you know, I really feel like when I go for a run now or I do something on my own, you know, I can hear myself saying those words. You know, I can actually feel that moment that you got during the Taylor Swift ride. Mm-hmm. you know, I can deliver that to myself at this point, and it's because, you know, I was present. Right. And I, listen, you know if you're working hard. I know when I'm working hard and I know when I'm not working hard.
Yeah.
And so I do think that part of the real goal was to train people to be their own coach. Mm-hmm. And there is definitely something, I think, when you fundamentally learn that and when you can feel that in your body, when you understand what pushing feels like and what it is to go to the next level, I think that it's really different than like looking at your wrist and saying, okay, I'm up, you know, from, yeah. And I think that there's absolutely a place for both, and we talk about it all the time, and we have so many internal discussions about what, you know, what place technology, you know, has played, plays now, and should play in the future. Mm-hmm. But I do think that for us, you know, one of the greatest gifts of SoulCycle is it is 45 minutes that you can escape and sort of like wake up and have done something good for yourself, but still, I don't know. I mean, we're all so attached to these things. I mean, stream of consciousness is just something that doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah. Now you have the same brainstorms that you do if you're in the shower or something.
To allow yourself to sort of go down that rabbit hole mentally, you know, I think to take that away by putting something that you're looking at and always sort of, I even think there's a huge difference between when you sit in the front row and you sit in the middle row.
Big time.
I was just having this conversation with somebody today. I was saying I have much more creativity when I sit in the middle, because I allow myself to sort of go places in my mind. Mm-hmm. When I'm in the front row, I'm a little bit more self-conscious. I'm looking at myself in the mirror. I might be pushing myself a little bit harder, but I'm definitely not as in my own world of thought and creativity as when I'm. So, you know, I try to mix it up, you know.
That's interesting. Okay, so here's where I start turning into a bitch. So you guys talk about technology, and you have, like, I mean, CEO of Twitter, friend of yours, huge fan. You know, like massive leaders in the tech. Yeah, why is your site shit?
It is coming.
I mean, I literally cannot book. I cannot book a class on my phone. Like, I mean, there are people.
We're not proud of it. Nobody's going to stand here and defend. Like, no, we're not going to stand up for ourselves.
Would do this for free for you.
Oh my god!
I have a theory that you actually want to throttle back reservations. Because I have to physically
I wish your theory was true.
On Monday. It is like, it's
It has been a very painful year and a half
for
us.
Oh my God, this has been, this is, We could throw up right now on stage if you'd like that. That would probably be a first.
Drink some more wine. It gets easier.
It won't be from the wine.
We are launching an app in 2 weeks. It's ready. It's tested. We're going to test it one more time because we've disappointed people many times.
Wait, what's
we're not launching this Monday, and we're not launching next Monday. we're launching in 2 weeks.
It's kind of, let's call it April.
More or less. What is she saying?
End of the month.
That's 2 weeks.
Yeah, that is 2 weeks. It's not April.
I'm calling
it's
it April.
So what is? Why is it taking this long? Tell me about the site.
We really screwed
it up.
Oh, my
God. Do we have to talk about
this? Yes. I can't just be nice to you guys.
Okay, no, that's totally fine.
And there are very few things I can bitch about.
No, okay, so you should bitch about this. It totally, I don't know. Is it, am I, it fucking sucked.
Yeah.
This process was terrible.
Let it
so
out.
So we, no, it's fine. I'm just saying, like, when we built our first reservation system, there's techies here, so you all can laugh about this. It was built on Cold Fusion, which is a total dinosaur, and now I know that. And but it worked fine.
It worked totally fine.
We thought it could be five studios, it could still run great. It could go to 10, it could go to 15. And then we looked at each other and we were like, oh my God, like there's gonna be soul cycles everywhere. We need technology to help this. And so we hired an agency that said they were gonna be able to do a great job with this and that they were gonna have some people who were gonna also be able to build it and it was gonna be perfect and it was
gonna
be beautiful.
And by the way, to the point of being fanatics about the brand, we never outsource anything. Everything is internal. PR is internal, marketing is, and this was the one time we thought, oh my God, somebody gave us a budget, we're gonna go hire an agency, this is gonna be amazing, keep going.
It didn't work.
We flipped a switch.
It did not work. It did not work. You know, we learned a lot.
And did they build it on, when did Flash come in?
Oh my God.
Because that's why you literally cannot book it on mobile.
I can't.
Like, for those of you who don't know, you go at noon on Monday, the bikes go on sale. And like my favorite class by 12:03 is sold out. So I literally have to be at a computer at noon Monday. It's the one time of my week I have to be. And there's like a system. Like, so sometimes Paul Carr has my password. Sometimes he has to book for me if it's like a very important meeting I can't get out of. Like, it's on Flash.
I know, it totally sucks. Listen, here's the good news. The good news is that absolutely by April, the app is fantastic. The booking app that we have is finally going to be great. I'm serious. Like, it's so good. We tested it on Monday, and this is so crazy, but I signed up for 61 bookmarks so I could just go through and see how fast and how many books I could get.
You can tab before you sign up.
So you tab. Right. So if you're a Saturday morning rider and you've tabbed your whole week, you can move Saturday to the top of the queue.
Uh-huh.
And then you can sign up for Wednesday next because that's the next class you want to be sure and get. And then you can sign up for the ones that maybe like the Friday too. That's not as much as trafficked as much can be at the bottom of your list.
That's nice.
There's a little bit of gaming, like you have to understand your own strategy.
Right.
Yeah.
So there is gamification, right, Julie?
Yeah, so gamification.
There's gamification in getting into the class, just not there.
You know what? It just takes, it's a whole experience. It's a 360.
So did you outsource it again or did you bring this in-house?
We actually brought an agency in to work with us on this, and honestly, they've been fantastic. So yay for them. And they are like our beacon of light. I mean, if you really knew us and understood like the gravity of the situation. Like, this sucked so much. It was horrible. It remains horrible. But like, we need to work around. Like, we want to keep giving people. Like, the last thing we want is for you to feel crappy at noon on Monday, which is what we delivered to all of the people who put their trust in us, which is a wonderful place to be. But we're really devoted to turning that around, and
I'm
we
so
have learned a
that.
Lot about That's technology right. in the process.
Right. And why do you guys not offer like playlists of the classes after the fact? Is it a music licensing thing or is it a competitive thing or is it?
We have stuff on, we have 20,000 followers on Spotify. We've got a lot of stuff going on Spotify.
Okay. So
I don't know. Post the playlists right after class kind of thing?
Like for some of them, yeah. I would pay extra to get like certain instructors' playlists after the fact. Because it's like, I don't want to be, I'm not having my phone in there, so I'm not Shazamming anything. And it's like, I don't want to be the person after who's like, what was the song you played right after
weights? Share that.
No, I mean, everyone in class does do that to them. I mean, these guys, truth be told, I mean, these guys are actually, it's actually part of their job to spend time before a class making their playlist and after class sort of.
And they launch a lot of music in there.
So they really do. Yeah. I mean, I've heard so much stuff for the first time in there. Mm-hmm.
Some of it's combative, you know. I mean, a huge portion of what we do in the room, I mean, so much of the experience is sort of the sequence of the music, the way that it's delivered, the way that it's put together and curated. And so, you know, we kind of made a decision early on that we were going to release kind of best of, you know, top hits of the month at SoulCycle, and not release kind of playlist for playlist. At this
There's
point,
a lot of stuff out there.
Yeah, at this point, so much of it is out there. You know, instructors are happy to give you their whole lists. In the beginning, we felt really sort of super proprietary about it.
Yeah, have you guys eased up on that? Because there's a lot of stories about you guys like not letting rivals like into your studios.
Oh, no, we're fine with rivals. We just don't like people knocking us off. Like, if you're going to bring people like train, you should actually train them in your own studio. You shouldn't train them in our studio.
Yeah, I mean, when people are bringing 10 instructors to take 600 rides each so that they can, you know, teach them how to teach at SoulCycle.
Right.
That just seemed like, and they weren't really forthcoming about it. That's kind of lame.
But I mean, how do you feel in general about knockoffs? Because it's like, I know one of the weirdest SoulCycle moments I had. I have one guy on my board who's like an invest, like seeming, he's not like this in his heart, but from the outside seems like a just like good old boy from Nashville, Tennessee. I mean, he is like, you know, central casting. And like, I went to his house once and he was like, well, my wife isn't here, so I can't offer you any lunch. I'm like, oh my God, how far have we come? So anyway, he comes out for board meetings. I always do a double on Sundays. So I'm like getting out of my 7:30 class, walk out, literally see Vic, my Nashville-based board member, standing in the lobby of Union Street, and thought, I worked too hard in that class and I'm hallucinating. There's no way Vic is standing in the lobby. And I was like, what are you doing? And he was like, oh my God, I'm so embarrassed. And he was like, I brought my wife out with me on this trip and she's been obsessed with SoulCycle and has like wanted to do it forever. And this is the first time we've been in a city that had it because it's not in Nashville. So she goes to Crank, which is a SoulCycle ripoff in Nashville. And she went, everyone talks about how does it stack up. And so she wanted to like go to one. And of course she made her husband go with her. And and they were like, oh, I'm so glad you're at class. I'm like, well, bad news for you, I do a double, so I'm also going to watch you work out in the next class. But he, first of all, he like could barely move after the class, which was great. He thought I was much more of a badass than he thought previously. But you know, there was this thing of, you know, and I asked her afterwards, like, how did it stack up? She's like, well, I think, you know, Crank is actually like pretty similar. Like, it's not quite as good. That's obviously like the gold standard, but like, there's shitloads of rip-offs, and I imagine one in a city you're not in doesn't bother you, or does it bother you? How do you feel about copycats?
Look, I mean, to be totally honest, like when we look deep into our hearts, of course we want to be everywhere and we want everybody to use SoulCycle. But the thing is, like, there's a serious problem out there, and if anybody is getting themselves on a bike, like, good for them. Like, people need to get cardio. I mean, that's what, we're like mammals. Like, these mammal bodies that we have, we need to do that. Mm-hmm. And so it's good that people are doing it. I mean, I think that's really, we kind of take a very high road, long view on it. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, you know, we're going to get to a lot of cities and we're going to launch a lot of stuff digitally. And, you know, we're definitely want, we think that what we have is special and we want to share it. But I think overall, as long as people are doing something, that's the main thing. Mm-hmm. It really is.
Do people poach your sort of superstar trainers? I mean, managing talent is such an issue. I mean, it's something that, you know, media organizations have to deal with. It's something certainly that tech startups have to deal with. You know, you create these stars and then, I mean, do they kind of have, like, are certain stars in certain markets kind of have you by the balls?
You know, it's funny. When we started the business, you know, that actually as we're talking about building a brand. I mean, it was always our vision. I mean, neither of us has ever taught a class. You know, neither of us have ever.
I'm really waiting for yours, I got to say.
But it's very funny. but, you know, we always sort of, one thing that we did know, even though we didn't know how big or how many we were going to build, we did definitely know that the model that was out there in fitness at the time was, you know, one diva builds a studio around herself. She can get 30 people in a room, mm-hmm. two, maybe three times a day, and that's the model. You know, and so we sort of really understood that we needed to build a brand that was bigger than a person. Mm-hmm. You know, and so it's, that has always sort of, we've always sort of eyes on prize that. And that's why we created a method. That's why we train people very thoroughly. That's why we do a lot. You know, we sort of search high and low to kind of find amazing talent before mm-hmm. we even put them through the process. There's no doubt, you know, people love their instructors, you know, and we love making them stars. And, you know, the one thing I will say is we've really never, I think in all, we have over 200 instructors now. I think maybe we've ever lost one or two ever in our almost, 9 years of business.
Have you had to fire any? Does anyone ever get through the process and then they're just like bad?
You know what's so amazing is that nobody hates the same person. Mm-hmm. Like you would think that somebody would be universally disliked, and that's not been the case ever. It's so interesting how it's about personality and chemistry, and there's somebody for everybody. So we,
have we ever had to fire somebody?
Yes. Yeah. Obviously,
does that happen a lot?
Yes. No. Not a lot.
I got to tell you, I've been no, it really for you doesn't in happen. LA. I had one instructor. This has never happened to me in SoulCycle.
That you want us to fire?
So uplifting and so whatever. And she was, it was such an LA instructor, and she was like, you know what? Just, if there's someone in your life fucking with you, just don't deal with their bullshit. Just, if you see someone walking up in the street and, they're not smiling, fuck them. It was, so aggro. And she's like, we all have that friend who's just dating a fucking loser. And, then she was like, earlier this week, I had to deal with some SoulCycle corporate bullshit. And I was like, I've never heard anyone speak ill of the corporate. And she was having a bad day.
And yet, happens to everyone. There's somebody who found that uplifting.
Probably.
Not kidding.
In LA.
Words to live by.
There's somebody that identified with her and thought she's going through it, and I'm going through it, and fuck it, we're going through it together.
That's so right, because we're all in it together.
So what does get an instructor fired?
No, I mean, there's been very,
not showing up,
very
like that,
few
or...
things. Exactly. The same things that, it's been maybe two or three people in the entire history, and it's the same things that would get anybody fired anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not showing up on time, not behaving well, being not nice to customers.
Right.
That kind of mm-hmm. a thing, but...
Theft.
The other thing I will say is, no, theft. Who's stealing?
I did not say that.
We'll talk about it later. We've been wanting to talk to you about something, Julie. We know you've been stealing.
No. No, but what's really interesting is that we were really intentional in the beginning about creating fitness careers for people. Because when we started, people would just pick up two classes here, and they'd pick up one class here, and they didn't have health insurance, and they were exhausted because they were running all over town, and nobody even paid them. And we kind of felt like, we're going to pay these people really well. Really, really well.
So how much does the average
make? These guys have great jobs. These aren't just jobs.
And they get health insurance.
They are careers.
Right. And they get, sorry.
No, first first of all, to your point, it's like, we build them into rock stars. We carefully program them to make sure that every single person is succeeding, that there's some sort of a thought pattern that goes into their schedule, mm-hmm. that PR and marketing make sure that they put resource behind them. So, we really, aside from training them, we also really make sure to try to support them and grow them up so that they mm-hmm. are, so that each person is their own rock star. We try to help them find their audience. Mm-hmm. But then on top of it, to Elizabeth's point, these guys have real careers. They have health insurance, they have paid vacations, they make a lot of money.
How much money do they
make?
They get clothing allowance. Really?
We have an on-staff physical therapist that treats them for free to make sure that their bodies...
Yeah. We invest in everybody who works for us.
It's a great
job. We believe that people really want to grow. And you should grow at work.
I'm going to be a SoulCycle.
By the way, everyone should be
you're
a SoulCycle.
You're not going out of business, but you're more than welcome to join us.
You never led a class?
No, we never.
Have you ridden on the podium?
One song for my birthday once I was forced to, but I don't love that.
It was the biggest fight we ever had.
It was not great.
I organized the party.
We do not ride on the podium. We've designed the experience. Mm-hmm. And
how often do you ride a week? True story.
Between 4 and 5 times. Not as much as you.
Yeah, well, a slow week I ride that much.
Yeah.
So the big elephant in the room, the conversation I have with every founder who takes SoulCycle, why the fuck did they sell?
We were going to California. Nobody'd scaled fitness before, and we wanted somebody who had done it so that we knew that if somebody went hunting, and because we're big rule followers, if it says to do this, we do it. But we were honestly concerned that we would just miss something because we were inexperienced and that it would take the house down.
And so it was the move to California that was really...
It was a big part of it. It was a big part of it, to work with somebody who has been a first-in-class operator for 20 years and seen everything, and really understood sort of the pitfalls and how to organize and how to scale. There's just a lot of great learning there.
We really chose Equinox more for the synergy than it was for the financial reasons. You know, we felt like we could lean on their infrastructure, you know, as we grew, legal, human resource, those types of things.
Build our own team.
Yeah. And they really have. I mean, they've helped us. They've really helped us build our internal infrastructure.
So as you're now on the other side of it and you're successfully opening up cities, do you ever have like moments of regret of like, we could have done this on our own?
Those guys have been valuable. They've helped us build our business. And, you know, every founder is a renegade, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, you could always play the story out in a lot of different ways. But I think that when we look back, we think that, look, what one thing about Elizabeth and I is, you know, we have always 1,000% believed in this business, and we have loved it, and we continue to love it, and we are sort of, you know, when people come up and tell us their passionate SoulCycle stories, I mean, every day we have our own passionate SoulCycle stories. We love it so much, and I can for sure say that we had the first in market advantage. I mean, we were the front runner for this thing by a long shot. And what we really knew was that, like, we wanted to be the brand that did this. And when the opportunity came along, I think we just thought, you know what, we need to keep running. At that time, we started to see copycats pop up behind us. You know, you doubt yourself, you know. You start to think, you know, was it lucky? As we scale, how's this going to happen?
You think you know what your secret sauce is, but, like, we see this over and over again with founders. They misidentify what it was that was successful. Like, they look back and think this one thing made them successful when it was something else. I'm sure when you start get into that, you're like, you know, we think it's totally unique, but what if there just is another spinning studio that has music and candles and it's $5 cheaper?
Totally. I mean, we thought all those things, you know, and so we just really looked at each other and said, you know, the thing that's important to us is that this, you know, we bring soul to the people, mm-hmm. and that the world gets this in the way that it wants to. And it was really about, it was really about delivering this experience that we were passionate about first, and making sure that we got into the cities that we wanted to get into, and that we were the market leader.
Yeah.
And I will say that that partnership did allow us to scale at a different rate. Mm-hmm. I mean, in hindsight, what you can look back and say is like, actually, like, we got this. You know what I mean? We knew it, and we still know it. And the truth is, we actually kind of did and still know what the special sauce is. And
we're good at what we do. We love what we do. And I think that's very validating, because you know, like to Julie's point, you're not sure, like, other people must know better. And then you get there.
You always think somebody else.
Oh my God, it's not so bad around here. We kind of got it, you know? And especially as we've started to like really explore what goes on in other companies, like, we're like, oh, this is great, man. This is a great place to work, and we work with like the best people in the whole world, and we just love everybody, and it's, you know, that part's good.
So is it, how did the sale change your life, not really in terms of financials, but in terms of like what you do, and just also your own stress level? Like, do you take vacations now? Like, what was the impact on it?
You know, the companies are really run pretty separately.
Yeah.
And so, the truth is it's hard to say what's different because of our partner. I mean, we grow by almost 50% every single year. Mm-hmm. So realistically, you know, it's more about the fact that we went from being a small company to being 1,200 employees and 40 locations. And, you know, we're just a much bigger company. And I think we feel that more than we actually feel the partnership. I mean, we kind of do what we're good at, and we lean on those guys for things that we need help with. Although we're actually getting to be the size company now where the things that we were able to lean on them for, we now need to bring in-house, because, you know.
And have done that, which has been great.
Yeah.
So we really get to run SoulCycle as its own its own thing, mm-hmm. which is kind of awesome. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's funny. It's like, I don't know, maybe people say this about children, too. It's like, you know, as they get older, your challenges get different. And I think that's really applies to a company as well. And it's something that's really fun about it, because it continues to be so intellectually challenging. Like, we just keep going. But you know, we're still working and just as hard. I mean, we're like joking with each other, like, who knew that, you know, the sprint was actually going to be a marathon. Mm-hmm. But it still feels good, and I feel like we're trained up and ready to go for it. And we, like I said, we work with really amazing people, and it just, we want to like
if you're going to be in this kind of business, you got to feel excited to go to work in the morning. And we still feel excited to go to work in the morning. And hopefully the people, we're really committed to the people that work for us feeling that way.
Right.
And I think there's like a good, hopefully virtuous circle. Doesn't mean that like you don't have a bad day because it's work, let's be honest. But overall, that's something that we always wanted to have happen. And it's kind of great that we've gotten to get to be this size as quickly as we have.
Right. So, last question, and then I want to open up to some questions from the audience. Leah's going to have a mic up against that wall. Sorry, you have to stand up so we can get it.
We do
on
go
camera.
On vacation, by the way.
Yes,
do you ever go on vacation together?
Or
are
you we try to vacation together because if we go to vacation together, then the other person doesn't feel guilty that somebody's still in the office.
Right.
Or somebody's not by it. Somebody, yeah. I love when you go on vacation, though, and I have the office to myself. It's a good thing, too.
You come back in all new decisions.
We have a sliding door between our offices.
We do.
It's so amazing.
Do you ever, like... Like, I'm closing the door. No, I need a break from you. Like, do
you
guys
have
fights?
It's never like that.
No, no. We try to leave the door open as much as possible because in the olden days, we used to make every decision together, you know. Do you think the wheel should be a little less yellow or a little more yellow? I don't know. Let's get together and talk about it. Now we both have really our own domains to run, and so we can't make all those decisions together. But I actually love to eavesdrop on Elizabeth's meetings because then I feel like I know what's going on in her part of the business and vice versa.
I feel like your meetings are more fun than mine.
Well, I know you get to deal with all the talent. That's
I deal with the talent.
She's like, I had the best meetings today. How are yours?
You're like,
mine were great. I love intellectual property.
Who deals with the merchandise? Because the merchandise is amazing. I don't want to get too deep into this because I do want to see if people have questions in the audience. But like, I'm one of those people who never buys merch. Like, I don't even wear Pando t-shirts. Like, I'm not one. And it's like, I'm embarrassed at how much SoulCycle merchandise I own.
It's so great though.
It is.
It feels so good on it. I love it. Julie does it. That's
I do.
And it changes every month.
We do 14 collections a year. We do one a month, and then we do a resort and a holiday. We have a lot of fun with it. Mm-hmm. We find that the retail really started out as marketing. When we were done building our front desk from IKEA, Elizabeth looked at me and said, okay, marketing, we got $2,000 left. What do you want to do with it?
You did a good t-shirt, though.
And so we made a t-shirt, really, and we thought if we could get, you know, the 50 coolest people we knew to wear the t-shirt, maybe people would start talking about our wheel. And, I mean, the philosophy of the retail was kind of born out of that, and people started to like wearing it, and so we started to make more and more of it. And now, you know, we find that we try to change the collection sort of so that the mood of the studio changes. You know, mm-hmm. we always sort of have a theme in mind, you know, whether it's something that is... you know, running concurrently with something that we saw on the runway, or if it's, you know, we have a festival collection coming out just in time for Coachella. you know, we always try to come up with something fun. And I think people love to wear the retail because, you know, we always say it's kind of like, you know, the best vacation you went on, you want to take something home from the gift shop. It's sort of a badge of honor for people. You know, I think people feel that they're, you know, the experience leaves them with such a high that you kind of want to take something home and have... Yeah, and gym clothes get gross too. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I agree.
Right. Now, in terms of the SoulCycle pants, I only like the ones that are so ridiculous that I could never wear them except to SoulCycle. Like, so I have like the super spandex ones that have like the yellow bikes all over them. Like, I have like all of the most extreme ones. Like, if I could wear this to the grocery store with a straight face, I'm not buying it.
You could. People do.
It's so funny because there's a designer that makes those tights who. Mm-hmm. My 9-year-old is obsessed with her. She makes them with, you know, gummy bears and paper clips all over them and, you know, things that Pop-Tarts, things that 9-year-olds want to wear.
Nice.
So she actually said to me, you should make these for SoulCycle. So we called up, you know, of course, the designer is a big SoulCycler.
Wow.
So I called Zara up and I said, you know, and my daughter Phoebe might have, you know, they're like trading cards. That's what the kids do with them, you know. And so she made them for us, and she continues to make us a ridiculous pair every single month.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
And I buy way too many of them. All right, Tom, take it away. Have you SoulCycled before?
Yes, I have. And thanks for the talk. First time asking a question, so it's scary for me.
Yeah, and he's come to like every single one. This is a compliment.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Sarah asked the crank question from the bottom end of things. I'm going to ask the really tough question about Peloton on the top end. Those guys make a bike, and when you talked about how you might go digital or, you know, what it's like to be in the community, my question would be, do you need to, like, control the lighting and the music in the house before you're going to do something like that? Or, like, what, you know, what how do you go about thinking about doing this remotely where it would make sense
right,
for your brand?
Right, an at-home experience.
Yeah.
We've been playing with that. We've been actually having such a good time working on content because we believe in content. Just because then that's the only way that the experience can translate. And so we have shot a bunch of classes and are sort of figuring out angles and lighting, and just so you can not be bored in 45 minutes by staring at a screen. So you're right, like there is definitely some nuance involved in it. But we're definitely making some progress on that. And we're excited to, once we feel like it's ready to get out there, then we will bring it out there. When we do that, I think what we're going to think about is making it agnostic in terms of its delivery system. So like it could go on your phone or it could go on your TV. It wouldn't have to just be on a particular screen. That's sort of what we're thinking about right now. Do you want to
How
add
far
anything
off
to
do
that,
you think
Julie?
That is?
Well. Everything's relative after
the
tech
app.
Crisis.
It took you a long time to get an app.
Oh my God.
Just saying.
I think things will start to accelerate more, thank God.
What do you want to do? You want to ride by yourself or you want to sign
hiring?
Up remotely?
What'd you say?
I want to sign up remotely. No, the bikes are expensive. I can't afford one of those bikes. I'm going to have to sell to Equinox to get one of those babies in my house.
Oh my God. They're good though, I'll tell you that.
Yep. Thanks again. So my question is, you touched on it a few different times. And I guess it's sort of a two-part question. So where do you see, I guess, the fitness industry going over the next 5 years? Sort of, I guess from a digital sense, do you see, you know, Fitbit sort of taking over the world, maybe not in SoulCycle, maybe in SoulCycle to some degree, like connected wearables, things like that. And then also, where do you see the trend of people, I guess, going to SoulCycle, but also having, you know, a gym membership and also belonging to like whatever, like a boot camp class also? Like, do you see the trend going more towards boutique and away from gyms, or kind of both?
You know, look, it's undeniable that the trend is toward boutique fitness at this point, which is amazing because when we started, you know, nobody really would have ever thought that. But, and to your point, you know, we've been doing this now for 9 years. I would say that, you know, boutique fitness has become really, really popular, like within the last, you know, 2 years type of thing. You see sort of, you know, all of these, you know, other boutique fitness concepts, you know, rolling out, putting one studio in, and then, you know, most of them going to about 3 studios. You know, we think it's actually great. You know, we've watched people get in such good shape over the 8 and 9 years that we've been in business that all of a sudden they're saying, hey, you know what? I now can do things I never thought I could do before, and so I'm gonna, you know, integrate, and I'm gonna, you know, do a boot camp twice a week, and I'm still gonna soul cycle 3 times a week. And there's no doubt that we're seeing a lot of that going on. And again, I mean, cross training is undeniably the way to take the very best care of your body. So it's really good. I think health and wellness in general, you know, it is so here. I mean, this is just so the beginning of this trend. It is going to be, you know, I think bigger than certainly we ever, you know, we always used to joke around that we sort of felt like we were on the front end of it, and that again, you know, SoulCycle with you know, something looking down over us, we were getting washed, you know, pushed forward with this wave and momentum. But it seems like it's really just beginning with, you know, the juicing and the.
I was going to ask you about that because in California, you're like next door to Press Juicery. Everywhere. Is there a formal partnership? Is that something that you guys might want to go more into in the future? Do they just see you sign a lease and they run
they
over
do.
And sign a lease?
They actually do.
And we've helped them. We've actually helped them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we are not. We are not looking at juicing or anything like that at this point. I mean, for us, we are rolling out so quickly that we did our corporate, you know, strategies. We did our offsite this year, and after everybody had 1,000 fantastic ideas of things we wanted to branch into, at the end of the day, the whiteboard said 3 words: hug the core. Which really, I mean, to roll out with integrity and to scale people and humanity, right. That's really all we'll be able to do. But I think you're going to see all of it. Mm-hmm. I think that people are just going to spend more money in general. I think more of people's salaries are going to be spent in this category. I think people are going to keep their gym memberships and add boutique fitness on top of it or mix it up with the boutique fitness. But I think you will see configurations of all of it. I don't see any of it going anywhere.
And they're definitely going to use wearables for sure.
It definitely seems like there's a change happening. And I know like the Birchbox founders talked about this. Like when more women started doing like Botox, suddenly spending $300 on face cream didn't seem crazy. And like how women spent on beauty really changed. And it seems like this with fitness, I mean, I feel like a lot of times I'll go to a SoulCycle class. This is so California. I mean, I swear to God, I grew up in Memphis, Tennessee. I don't know what's happened to me that I'm uttering these words, but a lot of times I'll go to a SoulCycle class with someone instead of like going to brunch, and it's the same amount of money you're spending for a different, instead of going to a movie, instead
it's two
of
cocktails.
Right.
That seems so like a good deal.
It seems to take away part of the wallet versus I think of this as gym or.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like part of your entertainment budget almost versus your fitness budget.
Definitely. I mean, we definitely have, I would say, you know, we sort of have, you know, our weekend riders, and there's no doubt that that's the event of the weekend. You know, I'm spending my $34 at SoulCycle, I'm meeting my three friends, and we're having brunch afterwards. But there's no doubt that many people consider it more a part of their entertainment budget than of their fitness budget.
I consider it part of my therapy
budget.
You
need to make that decision about what, I'm sorry, what did you say?
I said I consider it part of my therapy
budget.
Yes,
yeah,
we've
sure.
heard that too.
He definitely.
Awesome.
He I think goes we answered across so many platforms.
So let's see, no more questions. Oh, all right. Yeah. We've got time for you both.
Hi, thank you again. So I'm curious to hear a little bit more about how you decide which cities to expand to. I mean, that's something lots of businesses always talk about, all the research that goes into like every single Starbucks location or Trader Joe's. And obviously with 40 locations, you're looking to expand, I'm sure. So what's the research process like?
Early on, it was really listening to our riders and just seeing what they wanted. The day that we opened Union Street, everybody said Soma, Soma, Soma. And so we went, and that week we found a place in Soma, south of Market, and now we're open in Soma.
And you guys picked the worst Soma location. It's like there's not parking within a billion miles of that place.
Oh, that
and
really
it's like
sucks.
When there is a Giants game, uh-uh.
Terrible.
That's terrible. No one mentioned that. We really did ask about parking. We have a parking deal with a parking garage. I'll send you the information
on
that. Yeah. Because
okay.
I thought about that, but that's bad if it's not working. And now we look at demographics and we look at all the stuff that people look at when they're scaling more like national brands and things like that. You know, initially we made the decision that we wanted to put resources, just to the point of like why this thing costs money is because we invest in our people a lot to make sure that they're trained and they have resources and that the touch is good. It feels like a something you're doing for yourself. And the same thing sort of went to how we would cluster the studio so that we could have the support there than for the people who work there. And so that's how we kind of approached it. So for example, this year we're gonna roll out Washington, D.C. We'll have four locations in Washington, D.C. by the end of the year. And in April, we're gonna finally open in Chicago, which is my hometown, and I'm getting a lot of flack for the fact that we almost have 40 locations and none are in Chicago. But we'll have four locations pretty quickly in Chicago, and same in Boston, and same in Miami, and obviously we're doing a bunch more in San Francisco and LA, and then our next sort of big city move is going to be to London, because we want to do something a little bit more international, and there's a bunch of people who ride with us who are requiring that.
Thank you.
So to her point though, when it came to Chicago, like, why didn't you do Chicago sooner? Chicago's a big city. Like, what seemed to be lacking there where you did other cities first?
You know, I think it goes back to what Julie was saying, just about scaling people and just making sure that our infrastructure was clean and sort of well thought out before we started plucking off a lot of not that Chicago is random. Chicago is an amazing American city, and I love it very much. Let me just say, for the record. But I think that for us, it was the cluster. So if we have New York, like, you can get to Boston, D.C. on the train pretty easily. And in
right.
L.A., you can go to San Francisco fairly easily. So it just sort of made sense for us to make sure from an infrastructure perspective that we had that properly baked. Mm-hmm. And now that we do, we can start to branch out a bit more. And I think what you'll see is that we're going to go to the major American cities. Like, within the next 3 years, we'll be able to, you know, do these cities that we've been wanting to go to and that have been asking for SoulCycle. We get 1,000 requests a year for SoulCycle in your area, which
wow.
is kind of crazy. It's like three a day.
Yeah.
Like, and also a ton of international. It's very interesting. I mean, the planet has got, everybody says this, but truly, I mean, it's remarkable to me how small the world has gotten and how much impact a certain, you know, reach you can have. Like, we're punching far beyond sort of our
right.
size. We see like 10,000 people a day, and there's like, you know, 380 million people in the United States. Like, we're just starting.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
I'd love to see a SoulCycle in China. I'd love to see what that would be like.
Oh my God, there's some great YouTube videos of people doing that.
Their own SoulCycle like in China?
And like they do acrobatics and it's kind of, it's wild.
Wow.
I think liability when I see that. I'm not into it, but it looks good.
Jesus. All right.
So I have a question about you rather than the product. So as founders, you know, very clear that you believe in this mission. The dynamic between you is amazing. You've clearly worked your ass off for a decade to get here, but you've had an exit and you're working for a big co. And in the tech world, I've been through this a couple of times, that's a recipe to rest, invest for a little bit and then go off and do the next thing. So I just wondered, had you ever considered doing the next thing? And if you hadn't, given the plans that you're talking about, it doesn't sound like you have. But are there areas that are not SoulCycle, not health, you know, different verticals that perhaps you're interested in where you feel that you could also jump in and make an impact as well?
I mean,
What'd you call that? Rest and vest. I've never heard that before. That sounds awesome.
Which part have you never heard of? The rest or the vest? I think that we still have so much to do with this brand, and we work a lot, and we're pretty eyes on the prize. And it really, you know, with each city that we go to, and sort of, you know, each new experience that we're having. I mean, we've been able to do some amazing things, and we are still, you know, continuing to do some pretty cool things. This week we're bringing SoulCycle to South by Southwest. We're talking about going on a USO tour this year, bringing SoulCycle to the troops
that would
in Afghanistan.
Be really cool. I mean, that's the kind of thing. It's just
so there are a lot of pretty amazing things that we're working on that keep us pretty excited every day. Again, I mean, we are, you know, we have now been 9 years out in sort of the world of entrepreneurs. We are creative people, and we think about different things every single day. There is no doubt. Is there a next act for us? I'm sure that there is. I think that we're not ready to end this one yet. You know, our partnership is very, very unique. We're very interesting yin and yang. We didn't talk much about that, but we sort of have different responsibilities, and they really both fall into our core capabilities in a way that's sort of uncanny. I actually do think it was harder for us to meet each other than to find our husbands. A lot of different people could have done that. our partnership is pretty amazing, and I think that there are a lot of things that we could do and that we think about doing together.
What is the point you want to get SoulCycle to? When you say your eyes on the prize, like what is the thing? Because it's not an exit anymore.
You know, it's really interesting. One thing I will say is that my husband always says to me, he's like, you know, I was a banker for 25 years. I did a lot of great deals for people, and nobody ever wrote me a thank you note. And you get emails every single day about how much people love SoulCycle and aren't you so lucky? And the thing is, we are really lucky. Like, we are really blessed to be able to have this experience. And sort of goes back to a story that I didn't finish, but was our friend who was like, we're scared for you that you're opening in California. The best thing about that experience was standing in the lobby and the one-year anniversary of West Hollywood and talking to our riders, and the riders saying, like, I lost 15 pounds this year, but that's not what happened. You know, my sister had cancer, and I was in the hospital with her every single day. And the one thing that I did for myself is I went to ride, and I found so much strength in that room that I was able to be there for her in a different way. And that happens. There's so much stuff that happens to people, and we all need a place to go. And that, I think, is, to me anyway, just from a very personal perspective, that's still so gratifying to just have the privilege of being able to like put that into the world. And the fact that you know, can be a business on top of that where we can hire great people to work with us. I mean, it's just like pretty awesome.
And you're also giving jobs to very creative, athletic,
yeah,
sort of motivational speaker people.
And not just creative, athletic people. I mean, that's sort of another sort of interesting, you know, neither of us set out to run a big company. We, you know, we literally wrote on the back of a napkin if we could see, after we saw that space, we went across the street to a Starbucks and we wrote on a napkin that if we could have 75 people a day come to SoulCycle, we would be able to pay part-time babysitters. We'd have a business that we were passionate about, and, you know, and so it would be. And so,
we wrote it on a napkin because we did not know how to write a business plan. I mean, obviously, like, we're a lot smarter than we were 8 years ago. We have learned a lot on the job, which has been kind of awesome.
Been great.
You know, look, the long and the short of it is I think that every time we think we're about to hit the finish line, you know, we have a joke. We always stand, we open this seasonal location in Bridgehampton in the summer, and it's this big old barn, and there's this big wraparound deck, and we, for some reason, we always wind up reflecting, you know, sort of about the year past on the deck. And every summer we look at each other and we go, do you think this thing could get any bigger? You know, and inevitably the next year is like, you know, is, you know, produces so many more milestones. And I mean, for me, having lived in California for a long time, I mean, for me, a huge milestone was I just wanted to open in California. I thought, you know, God, to go back there and bring a business back there. And, you know, it was really like running a victory lap. And I remember, you know, opening our first studio there. And then, you know, we each have personal little milestones. I mean, I think for us now, opening in London is a big milestone. I mean, we really
we're letting go of Chicago.
That's your thing. I may or may not go to that opening.
Amazing.
Whatever, I got my hometown.
I had to wait till studio number 17 to get one in my neighborhood.
You should so ride funny. On the podium.
I'm in charge of real estate. For the first ride. So
anyway, you should ride on the podium for the first ride.
No,
you make
we
Julie
have professionals
ride on the podium.
That are really good at that. That would prefer, I would prefer to have to do that. Anyway, I know that's a very long winded answer. But
it's
we're
been amazing.
A great time.
I mean, and I think there's a lot more to do, and we think there are a lot of great ideas that we have, and so I think it will play itself out. But it feels like this thing is kind of just beginning.
Okay, great. Next question.
So you guys talk a lot about the physical experience that, you know, you get at the studio, but you do have a huge social media presence. Is that digital experience also a priority for you guys, or did that kind of just come from this, like, word of mouth grassroots thing that came from?
Huge priority. And I'll tell you the reason why it's been such a huge priority is because from our very first studio, all our great roots went back to that first studio. And because, like, I remember Julie telling this story about, she was like, oh my God, somebody said the towels smell bad. We got to fix the towels. And then we figured out that they changed the, you know, the detergent on them. Everything goes back to the towels, right, Julie? And
still like you, out the
and,
towels.
And somebody came up and said, like, the towels smell so much better. We're like, what did you do? And we said, oh, well, we changed it because somebody said that the towels smell bad. And we figured if four people were saying it, they must be really, really bad. And I think people are more accustomed to listening to their customers. Like, think about how quickly things have changed. Like, that was not something that people would, like, normally do. And so our social media was really built off of that, where if somebody, we answer 50,000, we have a and this is not a social media thing, which I will get to answering your question very directly, but we answer 50,000 emails a year from Your Soul Matters. So it doesn't matter what you write us, like, we will write you back. And so we have a very high engagement on social media. Our engagement is 95%. So we may only have 80,000 people on Instagram, but those people are so engaged. Like, I posted that I was in Chicago, and I was so excited about being in Chicago, and there were tons of comments, or we're like, we're looking for a CTO. I mean, what a great group to tell, we're looking for a CTO. And we had, you know, 100 people sharing that
Flash
with friends.
Programmers need not apply.
I mean, yes, thank you for that qualifier. We will definitely... Oh my God!
I can't believe we don't have you in our beta testing group.
I know.
We got to do that. How about next Monday?
You yeah,
next
can you
Monday?
Do that for us?
Sure.
Next Monday, we'll okay. get it on your phone.
Yeah. I am so mean. You're gonna regret it.
No, we love mean.
We need you.
No, we learn from mean. We're not afraid of mean.
Enough the last time.
Oh my God, I can't even. It was horrible. It was horrible. But yeah, that would be great. Mean is good. We like feedback. Anyway, so yes, social media, totally important to us. Engagement, so important to us. We love our customers. We want to hear from them. And it's a great way for us to stay in touch with people and for people to feel like they can access the brand. And we're in it. We love it. Does that answer it?
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for asking that. That was on my list. But I got carried away with spin crying.
What do you think about the trend for things like ClassPass and these kind of fitness aggregators? Obviously, you're not part of it. I would guess it's because of, like, brand protection, but what's your thought process there?
You know, we talk about it a lot in the office. You know, we can't decide if it's going to be the savior of all of these little businesses or if it's going to be what ultimately puts them out of business. You know, you could sort of speak to both sides of the coin, right? You know, it's they're helping them fill up seats that nobody would take in classes that they're running all day and they're already paying rent on the spaces, and at the same time, you know, it's they're discounting
they're severely discounting their brands, many of them not even giving themselves a chance to build a business before they begin to discount their business. I mean, there were certainly times in the beginning, by the way, there are certainly times in the beginning in every market we go into 9 years later where we look at each other and say, is it too expensive? Should we bring it down? Whatever. And then the answer is always no. You know, it's to give more, make the experience better. You can bring a friend for free, you know, bring a first-time user for free, offer the users that are already coming some sort of a, you know, some sort of a something, but not to discount. And, you know, it will be interesting. I think that,
it's not so sticky. That's what's perplexing to me. You know, we have riders, and this is something that honestly totally blows us away, and that, again, like, to the point of, like, a privilege to be in this business, we have people who still ride with us that started in 2006, and that is awesome. We still see them. It's, like, incredible. And the ClassPass thing does not seem to be that sticky, so it makes me just a little bit worried, because you got to find joy in what you're doing in order for you to value it, in order for it to get into your traffic pattern, for you to want to keep doing it. That's why gyms have memberships, because they just think, like, oh, you get inspired in January, and then, ha-ha, we got you for the rest of the year. So I don't know. I'm not sure. Like, time will tell.
I think people eventually figure out, you know, to the point of adding the boot camp in or whatever, I think people eventually figure out the one or two or three things that they love to do.
Yeah.
They drop the class pass.
And that they can really
And then they just wind up committing to those things in the times that they want to go. I mean, that's the other thing, right? I mean, you have a favorite instructor. You only have a couple windows in the day. You know, eventually, I think people wind up, you know, they use it as sort of a way to, you know, taste everything and then eventually, you know, drop it and lock themselves into the things that they really love. You know, what you hope for these little guys is that, you know, they're not discounting the brand so much that inevitably they can't make a go of it.
Great. Great answer. So, okay, I have two sort of final questions that I always end these with. I don't know if you've been prepped. But before we get to those, if you were going to do this again, so, I mean, you definitely sort of sent a signal that, like, your entrepreneurial journey is not done, as much as you're also not done with SoulCycle, and the two of you make a good team. Co-founders are incredibly important in this business. So you obviously would do something again, do something with each other. Would you raise venture capital at the outset? Because what you talked about, Elizabeth, was like everything went back to that first studio. And you learned so much from doing that one sort of crappy small studio with IKEA cabinets. And it seems to me if you'd raised a bunch of venture capital, if you were doing this in a time like now where, like, Blue Bottle's getting $80 million rounds, you know, I mean, it would have just been a different business and it would have taken a different trajectory. So would you try to do something like that, or would you do it bootstrapped again the way you did it?
You know, I we have had so much time, and I feel like I have not completed a thought, so hopefully you got a lot out of what Julie had to say. But, you know, one thing that happened in it was sort of an interesting journey financially, because, so we started the first studio, you know, it was $250,000 to get everything done, which, when you think about it, I mean, that seemed like a lot of money back then. And then I lived in Telluride, my best friend started this company called Izzy, and, we begged them to put money in, and they were like, no, we're totally losing your money. It's just so interesting how the landscape has changed so much. He was, like, afraid to take, it was like $50,000. He's like, I will lose it. Like, I cannot do that. Like, it's just immoral. And I wonder if somebody would have that conversation with their friend anymore. They would just be like, you're an adult, and which is exactly what I said to him. And then he called me the next day and said, Whole Foods just placed this huge order, and I don't have enough money to fill the order. I mean, it's, like, fascinating that's still... there's not that kind of mindset. The mindset has shifted, I guess, is what I want to say around that. And so what happened to us was that 3 months after we opened SoulCycle, God bless my husband and his Lehman Brothers job,
I love that you did air quotes around Lehman Brothers.
I mean, that was so crazy. I was so mad. Oh, I can't even, I shouldn't talk about that. But
You know, I just kind of, to roll forward on that, two things. Number one, we got a check in the mail. I remember standing in my kitchen going, oh my God, we got a check from Izzy and we're free. We're so free. And, you know, Julie and I were free. We were free to make whatever decisions we felt like were right for the brand. So if we wanted to spend money on something.
The 50,000 bucks she turned put into, it turned into exactly what it had cost for us to start our business.
Yeah.
So we paid her husband back. And we were like on our way.
Yeah.
And we never had to ask anybody.
No, and we could do whatever we wanted and we can invest the money however we wanted to. And that just felt so good because it just felt like we could be so authentic and true to what we wanted to do.
We would do it again that way. Definitely.
Although I will say, like, you know, we did it that way. And then when the meltdown happened, I mean, we were doing well. We were, you know, we had revenues at that point of, you know, maybe $10 million. And I remember going to Chase and saying, like, hey, you know, time to lend me some money. You know, the feds are backing you guys up. How about, you know, can you help a brother out? Mm-hmm. And they were like, oh, yeah, here's $100,000. I was like, I'm sorry. Did you see those zeros after the amount of dollars that I said we're running through here? Because I'd like to get some of those on loan. And they were not into it at all. I can go deeper into that story, but it really made me kind of insane. And it's just very interesting to see how the lending world has shifted for now. So I guess the point is that, you know, if there's liquidity and you can get liquidity and it's smart money, not dumb money, I don't really see the risk in taking it. But just, you know, given sort of where we've come from, I think our DNA has been formed. That's a long answer to a short question.
That's a good answer. I liked it. All right, so last two questions. What is the one thing that either you guys together or individually believe that few other people believe?
Huh. Wow.
You know what? I think that we actually believe in, this sounds so hokey, but I actually believe in basic human goodness. Mm-hmm. I actually do believe in that. As cynical as we can, it's not that like we're, you know, this is not like a Jack Handy show. Like we have lots of cynicism around us, but I think like very basically people tap into something that's good. I'm not sure that everybody believes that. It might not even be true. I might have to rescind that.
I believe that sugar is good for you.
Really? Mm, I'd like to hear more about
in
sugar.
That is not true. You just took all the snacks out of the office.
In moderation, I think it's fine.
I have that feeling about wine.
That was so brilliant. Oh, my God. I'm not
what
sure
is your sugar
good.
Vice? Is it, like, sugar in terms of, like, pasta or sugar in terms of, like, gummy bears?
In a syringe?
No, it's in frozen yogurt with a toppings bar around it.
Okay, she layered. Okay, let's get... This is actually really fascinating. Why don't you go through your whole
well,
thing?
Well, this is a whole other panel, but I'm also a frozen yogurt expert. So to give you all the details would be long-winded and very boring, but yes.
So that's why you started SoulCycle, to offset your calorie yes. addiction from yes. frozen yogurt yes. to break even.
Yes.
No, there's a reason I do doubles on Sundays.
What do you believe?
I have bottomless mimosa brunch afterwards, and
that's
I have
great.
To offset that somehow. What do I believe? Well, so I mean, mine.
You believe
is,
that nobody else.
Well, mine is very like company oriented, as I think a lot of stuff is with me. But I'm Capricorn. I think I can build a huge media organization off a small influential audience, and that I don't have to be behind a paywall, and I don't have to pander to page views. I mean, that's consistently been our contrarian thing, and we're still here, so we're getting there.
You can definitely do that.
Hopefully. We'll see. If not, I'll become a SoulCycle instructor.
It's a good job.
That's what I hear. Okay. Last question. If you could have one mediocre superpower, what would it be?
What?
A mediocre superpower. Would you like some examples?
Yeah.
Okay. So what I don't mean is what John Borthwick said, which was Russia. I do not mean that as a mediocre superpower.
That's so brilliant.
Literally took everyone in the room like 10 minutes to get it. And he was
so
not joking.
Good.
He thought that's what I was asking. He was like, let's see, Nigeria. I guess I'll pick Russia.
So, they have a lot of resources.
No, what it means is something like supernatural but has limits put on it. So I'll give you a couple examples while you think. So the best answer we've ever gotten, and I'm sorry, you all hear this every month because it's still the best one, is a guy who wanted to be able to temporarily detach his arm while spooning with a girl.
Really good one.
There is
And the best response I've ever heard to giving that was Elon Musk, who said, "You're in bed with a girl, and that's the superpower that you want." Elon Musk was very boring. It was beating traffic. A lot of the Valley people have very boring ones, like typing twice as fast, staying perfectly caffeinated. Destin Moskovitz from Facebook wanted to be able to like control the weather, but just around his hair on his bike ride to work.
Oh, I've got mine.
Okay.
I'd like to be able to be two places at one time.
But you put limits on it. That's too supernatural.
That's
two places at one time.
It could happen.
Like, I mean, you'd have to do that for like an hour a day or something like that. Like, you couldn't just constantly be in two places at one time.
I feel like there's so much I want to do.
That's too supernatural. I'm going to give you two places at one time. What about during meals? Because then you could eat and then do that. No, you want your two places at one time, so you're doing two business meetings at once.
She wants. Not even. Maybe I would like to work and go on vacation at the same time. Or maybe I would like to be here and be at my kid's school thing tonight. But being able to be at two places at one time would be awesome.
Okay, so would you like one day a week of that or 1 hour a day?
I'd like 2 hours a day.
Okay, I'll take it. Mm-hmm.
2 hours a day would be perfect.
But I have a request from you in exchange.
Because every day there's a double booking and I want to do both things.
So I am doing the Turn It Up to 20 promotion. And so I usually you basically do 20 classes in 30 days and then you get a hoodie. You spend $1 million and get a hoodie. It's ridiculous. But it's ensnared me.
It's like one of those machines you put the coin in to get the $1 yeah. stuffed animal out of.
Yeah, basically. This better be a great hoodie.
That would be a lot better.
But I usually do 5 to 7 classes a week. So normally this would not be scary, but I'm missing this week and you have to do it all in the same studio. So I'm going to get a teacher's note if I'm at the end of this. Because I'm here interviewing you. That's why I'm not in Union Street.
She's talking about two places
at
one time. Oh, yeah.
We might be able to allow it to be in multi-studios.
I mean, I'm going to try. But, like, if I don't quite get the hoodie, I'm going to be like, I was interviewing
you. How many days are you on the road?
Like 4 or 5. But I'm ahead. I think I'm going to make it. I'm going to do a double Sunday and then I'll only be one behind.
I think classes in New York could count for that.
I think you're getting the hoodie no matter what.
All right, but I'm going to try to earn it. Now I feel bad even asking. Now I feel like a total, like,
no, I love
wuss.
That. That's
all
brilliant.
Right.
I feel good after doing that, I have to say.
I mean, Elizabeth, what's yours? Sorry.
Oh, my God. I mean, I would like to eat, like, 12,000 calories a day and lose weight.
Yeah.
Does that count?
Obviously, yes. Well, I'll allow that and join you in that, mediocre
that
superpower.
I just don't want to think about that. I just want to work out because it feels good on my body, not because I have an objective. I don't know. That's such a good question. I love that question.
I like the 12,000 calories a day. You don't want to stick with that one?
Oh, yeah. But I think I should come up with more.
Okay. One of mine, which is gross, apologies, but you'll appreciate having had kids, is like when I was pregnant, I did a lot of these interviews pregnant. And it was like, they're very long, as you can tell. And it would be able to like, you know, like snap your fingers and you no longer have to pee. It just evaporates. I feel like the first couple years of this company being pregnant, I wasted so much productivity peeing.
Well, a lot of people take their phones with them to the bathroom. You know that, right?
I know. I've heard the stories about Ariana. Stuart Butterfield went up to me in our first PandoMonthly of the year. And what was it, Leah? He wanted to like, it was something about pooping in 2 seconds or something.
He wanted to poop in under 10 seconds. The 10-second poop.
10-second poop.
That's a lot of TMI.
Yep. That's nerds for you. Quantified self.
I'll take that. It's pretty great.
This is amazing. Thank you much for having us, guys. Big round of applause.
Thank you so much.